Hey guys, this is David Kwan. I'm continuing to pretty much read parts of 12 Years a Slave and reacting to it and putting my, like, you know, giving my some of my thoughts and comments on it. We begin in this video, you know, in the middle of chapter 10. Solomon Northup has escaped. He is now a fugitive. And so this is a very kind of perilous time. He's fleeing, he's running, he's being in the swamps, being chased by bloodhounds and dogs that have been trained to kill a fugitive black slave. Just pretty crazy. Anyway, here's a quote from middle of chapter 10. "Still, I staggered on, fearing every instant I should feel the dreadful sting of the moccasin, or be crushed within the jaws of some disturbed alligator. The dread of them now almost equaled the fear of the pursuing hounds. The moon arose after a time, a smile of light creeping through the overspreading branches, loaded with long, pendant moss." I think it's a terrifying thing. You're fleeing from hounds that are trying to kill you. You're entering a swamp full of alligators, and you know, you might fall and die. There's so much craziness here that Solomon Northup is experiencing as he flees for his damn life. Next quote. "I was in a stray, and if so unfortunate as to meet a law-abiding citizen of Louisiana, he would deem it his duty to his neighbor, perhaps to put me forth in the pound. Really, it was difficult to determine which I had most reason to fear. Dogs, alligators, or men?" any of those things, you know, he had reason to fear, but I would think men were the most thing to fear the most in this situation. Or dogs, actually. I don't know. That's a good question. Who do you fear the most? Next quote. "Even in the heart of that distant, dismal swamp, God had provided a refuge and a dwelling place for millions of living things." So I think I just highlighted that just to kind of the fact that, you know, Solomon Northup is a pious religious person, a faithful person, even after all he's gone through, and even at moments like that, perhaps especially so, you know, religion and faith in God is a source of hope, a source of comfort and solace to people in those kind of situations. It can be. Next quote. It's like the last part of chapter 10. "I was hungry and I was weary, but neither food nor rest afforded half the pleasure as did the blessed boy speaking kindness and consolation." So this is where he finally ends up. Yeah, you know, he finally ends up, you know, with a kind person who takes you to William Ford's place and meets John. So he is saved from this horrible situation of being a fugitive slave. Once again, by William Ford, the slave master. Chapter 11. So this is after he's now in William Ford's house, safe, and not a fugitive anymore. But yeah. "Mistress Ford came out presently, saying it was praiseworthy in me, but I was not in a condition to labor, and might rest myself at the quarters until master should go down to Bay of Bulf, which would not be that day, and it might not be the next. I said to her, to be sure, I felt bad and was stiff, and that my foot pained me, the stubs and thorns having so torn it, but thought such exercise would not hurt me, and it was a great pleasure to work for so good a mistress. Thereupon she returned to the great house, and for 3 days I was diligent in the garden, cleaning the walks, weeding the flower beds, and pulling up the rank grass beneath the jasmine vines, which the gentle and generous hand of my protectress had taught to clamber along the walls." I thought that this was a really interesting anecdote. Solomon Northup had just returned from fleeing for about a week. He was on the run for about a week or longer, if my memory serves me correctly. But he was out there for a long freaking time in fear, without much food, and his legs torn up and in pain. He comes back, he rests, and then the mistress, you know, Mrs. Ford, tells him, you know, you don't have to work. You can rest however many days you want before we go back to Bay of Bulf and return you back to your former slave master. And Solomon Northup is like, no, that's okay. I can work for you guys. And he actually, like, is glad to work in the gardens and clean stuff, you know, even though his body is in a lot of pain right now because of all that he's suffered. So for Solomon Northup, he feels grateful, you know, that he's able to kind of dude, it's, I in my situation would just be like, fuck it, man. I'm tired. Okay, thank you so much for letting me sleep. I'm just going to sleep for the next 2 days and rest. Thank you so much. That's what I would have done. I don't know, but I guess these are different times. And Solomon Northup has already kind of internalized the what white people of that time try to do with their slaves, you know, make them into pretty obedient, docile beings, not even humans anymore, but slaves. I feel like that kind of effect has already been, it's evident to see in this kind of time, even with someone like Solomon Northup, who's been free for over 30 years. Next quote, "The goodness of God was manifest," he declared, "in my miraculous escape from the swamp. As Daniel came forth unharmed from the den of lions, and as Jonah had been preserved in the whale's belly, even so had I been delivered from evil by the Almighty." This is what William Ford proclaims. Of course, he's a preacher, so of course he would say such dramatic things like that. "At such time," said he, "the heart of man turns instinctively towards his Maker. In prosperity, and when there is nothing to injure or make him afraid, he remembers him not, and is ready to defy him. But place him in the midst of dangers, cut him off from human aid, let the grave open before him, then it is, in the time of his tribulation, that the scoffer and unbelieving man turns to God for help, feeling there is no other hope or refuge or safety, save in his protecting arm. So did that benignant man speak to me of this life, and of the life hereafter, of the goodness and power of God, and the vanity of earthly things, as we journey along the solitary road towards Bayou Bluff." So I think this is interesting, because Solomon Northup is a pious man, he's a faithful guy, he's a religious Christian guy, so William Ford telling him all this, I think, it resonates with Solomon Northup. If I was this guy who just escaped slavery, this guy protected me, and now I'm at his house, and he's, you know, making me, traveling with me back to where I used to be, and telling me, this is the grace of God, you know. When people are living their normally lives, they tend to kind of scoff at God and not believe, but put them in danger away from human contact, and they're going to be very prone to instinctively turn back to the Maker. I don't know, I would have been like, not, I'm an atheist, so that doesn't resonate with me, but it's interesting, you know, these are, of course, different times, different people, different regions. Most people, you know, in America, back then and now, are extremely Christian and religious, so important to know. Next quote, "The slaves were astonished to find me there. On returning from the field, supposing I was drowned, that night again, they gathered about the cabin to listen to the story of my adventure. They took it for granted I would be whipped, and that it would be severe, the well-known penalty of running away being 500 lashes. Poor fellow, said Elijah, taking me by the hand. It would have been better for you if you had drowned. You have a cruel master, and he will kill you yet, I'm afraid." So, he now returns to Peter Tanner's home, and the other slaves are amazed that he returns. You know, they thought he drowned to death because they haven't seen him. Because most slaves aren't able to swim. They don't know how to swim. They were never taught it. They're forbidden to learn how to swim. But he returns, and Elijah says, "It would have been better for you to have drowned and died than come back, because your master, Peter Tanner, is a cruel one." Next quote is 10 pages ahead. "A slave caught off his master's plantation without a pass may be seized and whipped by any white man whom he meets. The one I now received was dated and read as follows. Platt has permission to go to Ford's plantation on Bayou Bluff and return by Tuesday morning. John M. Tibbetts." So you need this kind of pass. If you have this pass, you're okay. But if you don't, any black man found in the streets could be seized and whipped. And that's actually the law. You're supposed to do that as a white man. In this time. Yeah, crazy times, but that's how time was. Whew. Next one. The people that kind of get him back, they examine me in the most thorough manner. Catching runaways is sometimes a money-making business. If, after advertising, no owner appears, they may be sold to the highest bidder, and certain fees are allowed the finder for his services. At all events, even if reclaimed, A mean white, therefore, a name applied to the species loafer, considers it a godsend to meet an unknown Negro without a pass. So that's like winning the lottery for these people, you know. Oh my gosh, there's a Negro in the streets, and he doesn't have a pass. You know what? I'm going to make riches now, because I'm going to grab him and sell him to the highest bidder at the next auction. This is like humongous money-making opportunity for them if that happens to them in this time. Next quote. With his pass in his hand, a slave need never suffer from hunger or from thirst. It is only necessary to present it to the master or overseer of a plantation and state his wants, when he will be sent around to the kitchen and provided with food or shelter, as the case may require. The traveler stops at any house and calls for a meal with as much freedom as it was a public tavern. It is a general custom of the country. Whatever their faults may be, it is certain the inhabitants along Red River and around the bayous in the interior of Louisiana are not wanting in hospitality. So as long as you have that pass, whether you be a black man or a white man, you're going to be granted hospitality. So that's to be sure in the South. So there's a Southern hospitality there. Next quote. Her master did not knock her on the head, as is sometimes done to put a suffering animal out of misery, but left her unprovided for, unprotected, to linger through a life of pain and wretchedness to a natural close. When the hands returned from the field on one night, they found her dead. During the day, the angel of the Lord, who moveth invisibly over all the earth, gathering in his harvest of departing souls, had silently entered the cabin of the dying woman and taken her from thence. She was free at last. I like how there's so much like reprieve about death in this book. It's better to die. It's a joy to die. And in a, because slavery is so miserable that death is described as she was free at last. I think that's a remarkable thing. This is the last quote I'm going to do for the video. I was now no longer the property of Tibiets, his dog, his brute, dreading his wrath and cruelty day and night. And whoever or whatever my new master might prove to be, I could not, certainly, regret the change. So it was good news when the sale was announced, and with a sigh of relief, I sat down for the first time in my new abode. And that ends chapter 11. Next video, I shall begin with a long quote from chapter 12. Cheers.